like the band that Moses led.
Apologies for moving the service inside today on Zoom. We had a risk of rain, which showed up this morning, and there's a slight risk now, and we didn't dare have our equipment outside in case we got it rained on. So thank you for joining us on Zoom. I thank you to Skip By and to Bethany Grand for providing special music for us here this morning at St. John. A couple quick announcements, and then we'll begin our worship service together. Since we are inside, that does allow us kind of the opportunity to have communion together. So if you at home have any sort of earthly elements that will work, we'll join together in having communion. Those earthly elements could be bread and wine. They certainly could be grape juice and crackers. Just about anything will work. I always say if Jesus can turn water into wine, pretty sure Jesus can work with whatever we've got. So I invite you to gather those elements at some point during our worship today. We'll also allow some time for you to do that as we get to that part of the service that's not printed in the bulletin, that communion service together. Also this week, we have tomorrow, we have Mug Night. Men Under God's Guidance will be meeting on Zoom at 5:30. So you are encouraged and invited to take part in that if you would like. And this coming Wednesday at 2 o'clock, there's a new Bible study starting on the book of Jonah. So another water story, like the one we're going to get today in our gospel. So if you would like to be a part of that Zoom Bible study, you are more than welcome to join. The link can be found on our website or on our Facebook site. At this time, I would invite you to join me in confessing together our faith and confessing our sin and asking God for the promise of his forgiving grace. Let us join together now in confessing our sin. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to take a moment for silent reflection and personal self-examination. And now let us join together confessing our sin before God and each other. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and it is for his sake that God forgives us of all of our sin. As a called and ordained minister in the Church of Christ, and by Christ's authority alone, I declare unto each and every one of you the entire forgiveness of all of your sin, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And I invite you to join us in singing our opening hymn, number 581 in the Red Cranberry Hymnal, You Are Mine. I love you and you are mine. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
And let us pray. O God, our defender, storms rage around and within us and cause us to be afraid. Rescue your people from despair, deliver your sons and daughters from fear, and preserve us in the faith of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes to us from the book of 1 Kings, the 19th chapter. At Horeb, the mountain of God, Elijah came to a cave and he spent the night there. And then the word of the Lord came to him saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain, Elijah, before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so great that it was splitting the mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and he went out and he stood at the entrance of the cave. And then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." Then the Lord said to him, "Go and return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Jehu shall kill, and whoever escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elisha shall kill. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." Our second reading this morning comes from the book of Romans, the 10th chapter. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, "Do not say to your heart, 'Who will ascend into heaven?' That is to bring Christ down. Or 'Who will descend into the abyss?' That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? 'The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart.' That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified. One confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, 'No one who believes in him will be put to shame.' For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how can they believe in one whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone proclaiming him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As is written, 'How beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news.'" Here ends the reading. I invite you to join us in our gospel acclamation. Here comes Jesus. This morning comes to us from the Gospel of St. Matthew, the 14th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side of the Sea of Galilee while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but by this time the boat, battered by waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And so he said, "Come." And Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, beginning to sink, he cried out, "Save me, Lord." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace to you all and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. I have to admit, today in worship, there are a lot of favorites for me. This is absolutely one of my favorite gospel readings. "I Love You and You Are Mine" is one of my favorite hymns, along with "You Have Come Down the Lakeshore," which is coming, right? And so as I thought about this gospel, I was trying to think about what is it that seems to really resonate with me. I think at least in part, some of it has to do with the fact that I grew up on a lake in Minnesota, a very large lake, Leech Lake. And I've experienced the power of being out in the water when the wind comes up and then the waves start crashing against the boat. Spending more than a couple fishing trips with my dad as we tried to make our way back from the depths of the water back to our dock. One of the things that really grabbed my attention this morning as well is that there's a deep sense of immediacy in this text that I don't think I've ever caught before. Three times today in our gospel reading, we hear the word "immediately." The first time happens when Jesus is, at the beginning of the story, inviting his disciples to get into the boat and to go to the other side of the sea. It says, "Immediately, he commanded the disciples to get into the boat." And then we hear that Jesus, as he's walking on water to the disciples, and there's great fear, that immediately Jesus spoke to them, bidding them to not be afraid. And finally, as Peter is sinking in the water after having attempted to walk out on the water to Jesus, it says, "Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him up." I have to admit that this sense of immediacy has never really struck me in the past, because in the first two cases, it just doesn't really feel like it's there. There doesn't seem to be such a deep sense of immediacy. But certainly I get the sense where Peter is sinking like the rock that his name means, right? As he starts sinking into the water, I can sense that if there's a risk of drowning, that there would be an immediacy there. But the other two instances don't seem, at least in my mind, they didn't seem to make a lot of sense. And so I have wrestled with that for this morning. And I think we're going to try to unpack that a bit as we go through the sermon today. But as we get there, let's see if we can begin to try to make sense of what's going on, why there's such a deep sense of urgency in this gospel reading. As for now, let's look a little bit at what has happened right before this. Just a few verses before this story in Matthew's gospel, we've gotten word that that John the Baptist has been beheaded. And Jesus has wanted then, after receiving that news, to go to a deserted place so that he can pray and, I think, live in the midst of the grief. And so Jesus goes off to a deserted place with the disciples, but he's followed by this huge crowd, right? This crowd that we heard about last week, this crowd of 5,000 men and women and children as well. And he has, it says, compassion on them. And ultimately, we know that that is the feeding of the 5,000, right? Jesus tells the disciples to feed them. And then disciples provide whatever it is that they have, a few loaves of bread and fish. Jesus blesses those loaves and fish and tells the disciples to give those meager goods to the crowd. They receive them, and everyone has more than enough to eat. It's right after this story then that Jesus commands his disciples with a sense of urgency, immediacy, to get into the boat as he dismisses the crowd and then goes off to pray on his own. And the very next thing that Matthew tells us is that, and I found this interesting, that the disciples get into the boat and they're far from shore, being battered by the waves because the wind was against them. That it was in the evening that Jesus seems to notice that they are being battered by the waves as the wind is against them. But it says in Matthew's gospel today that it's not till morning that Jesus comes walking on the sea. So he sees them in the evening being battered by the waves as the wind is against them, but he doesn't seem to get a sense that there's a deep fear in them, right? And it seems to be the case that these disciples don't seem to be afraid by the water and the waves and the wind that is keeping them from getting to the other side of the sea. And it makes sense. I guess they're fishermen. They probably understand how to navigate choppy waters. But Jesus comes walking on the water that next morning, and the sight of him is what evokes fear in our gospel reading for today. They see him, they think that maybe it's a ghost, and then speaking to that fear, Jesus cries out, "Do not be afraid. Take heart, it is I." And then the part of the text that for years has always been the most interesting part of this gospel for me takes place, for Peter shouts out the words, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And as most of us know from this gospel story, Jesus says to him, "Okay, come on over then, Peter." So Peter gets out of the boat, begins to walk on the water. But then when he takes note of the wind, he becomes frightened and he begins to sink. Now, a pastor that I've enjoyed listening to and reading for some time is a pastor by the name of Rob Bell. And in his book, Velvet Elvis, and in a video series that he does as well, he talks a little bit about his interpretation of what's going on in this text. He talks about how within the Jewish culture, a rabbi was the most revered member of society. And for a rabbi to invite one to come and to follow them, to be their disciple, was a great honor. He also says the goal of a disciple was to be like the rabbi and to do what the rabbi does. And so when Peter sees Jesus walking on the water, when Peter calls out, "Lord, call me to come to you," he's trying to, I guess, in Rob Bell's interpretation, he's trying to be like the rabbi and to do what the rabbi does. I think that that could be at least part of what's going on here. I'm not sure it's the whole part of what's going on, because when Peter doubts, right? Bell says, who is he doubting? Is he doubting Jesus' ability to walk on the water? Is he doubting his own ability to be like the rabbi and to do what Jesus does? Bell suggests that it's Peter who doubts himself. And I think that that could have at least a part of what's going on here, but I'm not sure that's the entire story. At least in part, I think what Bell is suggesting is that we are invited by God to do our best to be like Jesus, to try to live a life that extends love and care to others. But I don't think that we are expected by God to be Christ, right? To be the one, the Savior of the world who takes away our sin, to be perfect. And so the part of this text, right, that has always been a struggle for me is the part where Jesus says, "Peter, why did you doubt?" Because it seems, at least on first hearing, that there is some shaming going on there, that Jesus seems to be attacking Peter's belief in Jesus. As a Lutheran pastor, I'm more than aware that much of how faith has been understood for many, if not most people, over generations is in this kind of intellectual assent of belief, this way of kind of believing that we have to accept Jesus, we have to believe with our whole heart, or else we risk the threat of hell. There is for many always a lingering sense of doubt and worry that God may really love me, that I have done everything that I can to be loved by God. And I think that that's a problem when we think of faith as this thing that we have to accept, that we have to claim as our own, which I think we do. I do think we claim faith as our own, but I think it's a gift that's given and extended to us without any sort of intellectual assent on our own. I don't think that we have to, let me say it this way. When Luther talks about faith, right, in the third article of the Apostles' Creed, he talks about it as being a gift. He says, "For I believe I cannot by my own will or understanding believe in Jesus Christ or come to him, but I have been called, enlightened through the good gifts of God," right? That God has come to me through the gift of the Holy Spirit, which has then allowed me to respond to God's gift of grace and faith. And I think the challenge of this text is to read Jesus' response to Peter as Jesus shaming Peter for not believing strong enough, for doubting. But I wonder if what's going on there is something else. I think a part of this gospel story that gets overlooked is that Jesus, as he's walking on the water, shouts out to the disciples, "It is I, do not be afraid." And then Peter says, "Lord, if it's really you, if it's really you, then call me to you." Right? And I wonder if that's the doubt Jesus is pointing to. Jesus has just let them know that it's me, and I'm coming to you. That we have a God who comes to us in the midst of the storms of life, in the midst of the water and the waves. And Peter seems to doubt that we have a God that would do that in Christ, a God that would come to us. And I wonder if it is that doubt that Jesus is speaking to. "Peter, why did you doubt that I would come to you in the midst of the water and the waves and the storms that rage around?" What's perhaps the most interesting and extraordinary part of this gospel is the promise of a God who walks to us, a God who comes to us, a God who sees that we are in the struggles of life, in the boats that we travel in, that we are being battered by the waves, that the wind is against us, and yet we have a God who comes to us on the seas of chaos that we find ourselves in. I think that that's where the immediacy of this text really comes from. And I think that's what Matthew's trying to point to, is that we have a God that doesn't allow the storms to drown us, it doesn't allow the chaos of life to get a hold of us and have us forever. We have a God who comes to us out on the seas, out when we are being tossed about. When I worked at a Bible camp in Colorado, before we left the camp for the summer, we worked out there all summer long, and before we left, the director of the camp came to us with a big pitcher that he had. It was a large pitcher of a sailboat out on the waters, and below the sailboat was the caption, a boat in the harbor is safe, but that's not what boats are meant for. A boat in the harbor is safe, but that's not what boats are meant for. I think Jesus invites those disciples to go to the other side of the sea, understanding they might encounter the rough waters, but also that they have a vocational calling in Christ to go to where the need is next, and that they have a God who is with them in the midst of whatever they might face on that journey, the storm that rages around them, the wind and the waves. They have a God who has come to them in Christ to claim them now in the immediacy of love. We have a God who comes to us, who claims us, and who promises that nothing will be able to separate us from God's love. What a wonderful word, an immediate word that we need to receive day in and day out, that we have a God who comes to us. Thanks be to God for the gift of God's presence in our lives. Amen. Now I invite you to join us in singing our hymn of the day, hymn number 817, if you have a hymnal at home. If you don't, you can find it printed on that online bulletin, and the hymn is "You Have Come Down to the Lakeshore." Thank you. invite you to join me in affirming your faith this morning through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now with the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all according to their need, let us pray to God and lift up those who are in need of God's loving care. And let us pray. Gracious God, our refuge and shelter, guide us as we live our lives trying to respond to your claiming grace. Be with all those who are in need, those who have experienced the power of the storms that rage around them, those who feel the waves crashing up against their lives and who feel the strength and the power of the wind against them. Help them to be reminded of your faithfulness and love, of your presence in their lives, and help them to know that they are not alone no matter what it is that they might face. For we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, who holds us in our anxiety, God of grace and mercy, be present with us as we face an unknown future and as we walk past untrodden. In the ever-changing and uncertain world where we find ourselves, help us to know that we to know and to be assured that you are God of our lives and that you hold us in your loving arms. Guide our living, calm our hearts and our minds, and give us hope in you, for we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, help us to care and to tend for the gift of your creation. Help us to be mindful of those around us who are in need of kindness and love in their lives, and help us to be instruments of your peace around this world as we tend for all that you have created. For we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we belong to you and to each other. The Bible says that where two or three are gathered, you are there with us. Help us to be reminded of your faithfulness and presence in our lives, and help us to find confidence and peace in the gift of your presence, for we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for your hand of healing and wholeness upon all those who struggle from all forms of illness, whether those illnesses be mental, spiritual, or physical. We lift up to you this morning all those within the St. John community and beyond who are in need of your care. We remember especially this morning Harley and Betty. We remember Cliff and Gloria, Janelle and Dennis, Kim and Jane, Linda and Lynn, Galen and Jean, Jerry and all those who we name before you in our hearts at this time. Gracious God, wherever there is a need for healing and wholeness, we pray for your presence and your peace, for we ask, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up to you all those who are grieving the passing of those that they love. We remember especially Kathy Knutson, Don, who's the other one?
Bob and Suzanne Schultz,
thank you. And those that we name before you in our hearts, those that we miss. For all who grieve the passing of loved ones, we pray for your presence and peace, for we pray, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
All these prayers and the prayers that we lift before you in our hearts, we commend to you, trusting in your love and in your grace through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
May the peace of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ be with you all. And at home, as you extend that peace to whoever might be around you or as you do it virtually online, I invite you to take some time to do that. And then if you haven't done so yet, I invite you to go ahead and get those elements and we'll be receiving communion together in a short time. And I invite you to join me now in our communion together. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying to them, "Take and eat, for this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of your sin. As often as you drink from this cup, do so for the remembrance of me." As we prepare now to receive this gift of God's claiming love and forgiveness, let's join together in praying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And I invite you at home to receive the gift of Christ's forgiving love through this gift of his claiming grace in communion with these words: the body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. Now may the body and the blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in your faith and in God's grace this day and forevermore. Amen. And let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this claiming gift of your love. Strengthen us through this gift so that we might serve you in newness of life, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you now to receive this benediction. May the Lord our God bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God this day look upon you with favor and give you peace in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And we'll join together in singing our sending hymn, number 773, "Precious Lord, Take My Hand."
I am too tired, I am too
used to love and to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.